And we're back on the Emerging Business Report. Thanks again for tuning in. Now, Christopher, before we left in the last segment, we were talking about money. Mm-hmm. Show me the money. How did you find the funding to open your own business?
Well, as I was saying, as you gain a reputation and people have confidence in your ability to do the job, believe it or not, money is easy to get.
Really?
People think that money is hard to get.
Yes, I think that.
money is not that hard to get.
Okay, tell us your secret.
So the deal is this. Like I said, I had people who already knew that I knew what I was talking about. So when it was time for me to start the business, I reached out to some friends of mine who already had their business that did consulting. Primarily in the IT space.
I see.
So what we did, we teamed together.
That's important. Those partnerships are important.
Right. We teamed together to service the client. And so it was great for me because, you know, I was able to get the payroll and all that stuff taken care of through that partnership. We structured the deal so that the funds that would come from operations would go straight into helping me make sure I made the payroll. And so, like I said, you know, the money will come if you have the expertise and people have faith in your integrity and your ability to get the job done.
And relationships and partnerships are very important in any business.
Well, the relationships are very important. I would say the right relationships, because in this business, especially in the Washington, D.C. area, there are a number of consulting businesses, services firms,
yes.
And, you know, from varying sizes, and a lot of people talk a lot of stuff. And so I think it's critical that you gain relationships with people that you can trust and understand the fundamentals is that no one's going to give you anything for free. They all want something in it for themselves. Just like you as a business owner, you want money and prestige and whatever it is you're in business to do. You want some things, they want some things. Understand what those needs are and make sure that you're both in 100% agreement on what each other's roles are. It has to be very distinct roles and you have to be providing value to each other.
Okay.
And that's how the partnerships work. And then what you'll find is as you make money, the banks want to give you money.
Oh, of course.
They want to make money.
But you have to prove yourself.
But you have to prove yourself. So it's critical that you build up your reputation, you build up your integrity, you build up your past performance. And that's when people are more willing to take risks on you. So I think the money hard to get thing is a misnomer.
Okay. It comes as long as you can prove yourself.
Exactly.
Okay. Now, we were also saying that the market of information technology is a competitive one.
Yeah.
So what sets Radius Technology apart from all of the others?
Well, I think one of the things that separate us is that we've concentrated ourselves around some core services. We don't try to do everything. Like there's IT companies that'll build a website for you that will lay, you know, network cable. We don't do those things. What we do is information assurance. We do physical security as well, and we do some management consulting. So we kind of stay in those niches. On top of that, I think what's even more important than those niches is the customer service.
Okay.
At the end of the day, the client wants to feel very comfortable doing business with you.
Yes.
You want to make it easy doing business with you. You know, if the client says, look, I need 10 people, you know, in the next 2 months, you say, okay, we'll get it done. Or if you can't get it done in the 2 months, you say, look, 10 people with this type of skill set, these type of clearances, getting them within that time frame really is not realistic. This is what we think we can do, and this is why. And being honest upfront and delivering on the customer service and what the client really needs is the most important thing.
I was going to ask you, what do clients look for? And you just answered that question. But the honesty part is important, too, because if you can't deliver the service, you need to be upfront about it.
Yeah, especially when you're a small business in this marketplace. You know, the rush is, wow, we got a $10 million contract. Wow, you know.
Right.
But then when you look at the details of the contract, has the client really specified what they really want? Can you get the people in place that's needed to do the job?
Can you deliver?
Right. And do you have the financial backing to get the work done?
Even if you get a $10 million contract, you still need financial backing.
Oh, well, when I say financial backing, meaning that you have to have the ability to meet the payroll and all that stuff that goes along with
it.
So, for example, if someone wants to give you a $10 million contract, that over 5 years, that is approximately $2 million a year, right?
So, yeah.
And so your payroll is probably going to be at least half of that, right?
Yes.
So then you got to make sure that you got enough money to pay those people because...
For that 5 years.
Yeah, because payroll,
yes.
Health insurance...
Yes, it adds up.
Those are the most important things.
Right.
You can do everything else wrong, but you come late with the check.
All right.
It's over for you.
And health care is important,
yes,
too.
Yes, and they'll tell the clients that, you know, I got a terrible employer and all that stuff, and it'll ruin your business.
Okay.
So you got to take care of your people. You got to take care of the clients. Everything else will work itself out.
And I'm glad you said that because $10 million sounds like a lot.
It's not.
But over a 5 or 10 year mm-hmm. Time frame, it's not a lot.
Yeah, I mean, I'll take it. You know?
Right,
I mean,
of course.
We're going to take the money. But the thing is, you got to really do some hardcore analysis if you can do the job, because sometimes in the marketplace, the clients don't always know all the detail and all the things that go into
that goes
delivering
along with
the
it.
Service.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
So you can have a $10 million contract and lose money.
Let's talk when we get back mm-hmm. about the challenges that minority businesses mm-hmm. face, mm-hmm. Especially in these hard economic times. We're going to talk a little bit about that when we come back from the break.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Please stay with us for more great information from successful business owner Christopher Archer of Radius Technology. We'll be right back.
And what I found is that with a lot of minorities, they're not, as I would like to say, plugged into the dream.
I think the biggest challenge in being a business person is finding the confidence to stay in the game.
There's a lot of companies that do what we do, and we had to make absolutely sure that our customers understood what we offered was better than what everybody else offered, and that we had a chance to make them, our customers, better.
Welcome back to the Emerging Business Report. We're having an engaging discussion with Radius Technology Group CEO, Christopher Archer. Now, Chris, let's talk about some of the challenges that minorities face in business. Do you think that they exist, and if so, why?
Well, yeah, I think there are some challenges. Most of the challenges I find is more of a mentality and a mindset, especially in America, where, you know, there's so many opportunities for people in general. And what I found is that with a lot of minorities, they're not, as I would like to say, plugged into the dream, into the American dream.
What do you mean by that?
The American dream being that you can succeed if you work hard enough and you work smart enough and you have a passion for whatever you do. And so what I see with a lot of minorities, especially in the Black community, is that dream of, hey, you can do whatever you want, you can be successful at whatever you want, you just got to work hard for it. Sometimes you don't have that dream that's passed down. I see a lot of non-minority in communities. You know, they got the dream of, okay, yeah, you're going to go to Harvard, you're going to be successful, you're going to be a skateboard, you know, a superstar or whatever that is. I think with, especially in the Black community, we have a bit of a struggle on some level of selling our kids that dream. A lot of times because, you know, we're just trying to get the bills paid.
Okay. And do you ever go out and talk to kids about how possible it is to start your own business, how hard it is, mm-hmm. the work that comes along with it.
Yeah.
Nothing in life, of course, comes easy.
Mm-hmm.
But do you ever get a chance to go out and talk to these kids about
well,
that?
Well, I don't get out like formally and do, you know, a lot of, community outreach type stuff. But I do get and come across a lot of young kids throughout my day-to-day workings, and I also have an intern program at our business, and so we try to bring in kids that have some type of desire to get in business and want to learn and understand that it takes some work. So I try to just lead through example And after I retire, I plan on teaching. So hopefully that'll be my bully pulpit.
Maybe you can come over to Prince George's Community College and do some teaching.
Yeah, if the money's right. No, I'll play.
What advice would you give to entrepreneurs who are just starting out and trying to obtain the type of success that you've obtained?
Yeah, the first thing is whatever business that you want to go into, work for someone else that's already in that business.
Okay.
Even if it's, you know, working for pennies, even if it's for free, you want to get your education on somebody else's dime.
Or an internship.
Like, or an internship, something like that. And especially if, you know, you have a dream about owning a restaurant, you have to go work in a restaurant business because it's a tough, tough business.
And you may not like it.
And you may not like it, right? You got this pie-in-the-sky dream that you think you want to be, you know, a club owner or something like that. And then when you start working in industry, you start seeing it's really tough. And you know what? The payoff may not be worth it. I like to work smart, not hard. So, you know, I try to figure out the most efficient way to get a job done. And I think the best way and most efficient is to work in the industry that you think you want to be in.
Okay, sounds good. Now, where do you see Radius Technology Group in 5 or 10 years from today?
Well, I see us quadrupling the size of our business. What we've been doing in the past 2 years is really building up the infrastructure, updating our accounting systems, and putting people in critical areas to poise to handle the bigger business that we have coming online. This year, we're slated to do double the business and new contracts. So, you know, I think we can quadruple a business in 5 years, and in 10 years down the line, who knows where we'll be. So,
good. Well, we definitely appreciate your being here on the Emerging Business Report, and certainly wish you continued success. And know we'll see you real soon.
Oh, thank you so much. I appreciate the time.
Sure. And thanks again for joining us today. Please be sure to tune in for the next Emerging Business Report. Have a great day.